Hey everyone, my name is Brandon Robbins and welcome to Beyond the Words, where we reveal to you the context, history, and other details of Scripture that will help you to understand the Bible more easily and see it in an entirely new light. Now for the next few months, I'm going to be taking you through the Gospel of Mark, breaking down each chapter and showing you the key elements that will make the text come to life and allow you to understand everything even more clearly. Many of you have shared with me that you want to read the Bible, but you just find that it's not easy to do it, right? You just don't understand it. And so we're going to help take that barrier away. And in this video, I'm going to introduce you to some general things that you will want to know as you read through this gospel. So let's jump right in. The first thing that is important for you to know is, why is Mark called a gospel? What does that word even mean? Well, the word gospel comes from the Anglo-Saxon word godspell, which means a good story, and is based on the ancient Greek word euangelion, which means good news. In other words, this gospel is a story telling the good news about Jesus. Whenever a Roman emperor would conquer an area, he'd send out euangelion, good news about how everyone's life was going to be better because he was their emperor. Well, Christians did the same thing with the story of Jesus. They wanted to let the whole world know that their lives would be changed forever because of what Jesus had done. And the reason this gospel is called Mark is because, according to tradition, this telling of the life of Jesus was written down by a man named Mark, who was a disciple of Peter, somewhere around 30 years after Jesus' death, give or take. There's a lot of debate about this. Nevertheless, these details matter for several reasons. First, they tell us that this account is coming from someone who knew Jesus, who saw these events. If Mark is getting these stories from Peter, then these aren't accounts that could possibly have been altered over time. This is Peter's own reflection put on paper through Mark. Second, these details give us a hint that Peter himself is going to be a very prominent person, an important person in this gospel, which we're going to see as we go along. And finally, the dating of this gospel tells us that this gospel is being formed during a time of intense persecution against Christians, both by Rome and the religious leaders in Jerusalem. Christians fear for their lives. They're opposed at every turn. And we'll begin to get a sense of this through Mark, through the way that he tells and recounts his stories. The next thing you need to know as you begin to read this gospel is that while Mark might be writing a biography, he is not writing a history. At least not as we tend to understand that word. For us, history is an accumulation of facts about a specific period of time. The emphasis is on accuracy. History tries to be objective, to give the most accurate reflection possible of that time and the events that took place. But this is not Mark's goal. And one of the big reasons for that is that this wasn't the goal of biographies at the time of Mark. The emphasis wasn't on getting all the facts right, so much as it was inaccurately, albeit subjectively, telling the story of the subject of that biography. So as you read Mark, and specifically as you read the accounts of other gospels alongside it, you'll notice that sometimes things don't always agree. Details might be different, stories might be in a different order. But as far as Mark is concerned, that's fine. His focus isn't on giving you all of the historical facts and an accurate chronology. His focus is on telling you the truth about Jesus, that this man is the Messiah, that he died and rose from the dead, and by putting your faith in him, your life can be changed forever. Everything about how Mark writes, the order he tells us his stories, the words that he uses, the details that he includes, is meant to drive home that essential truth. The third important thing to realize as you read Mark's gospel is that when this gospel was written, the average person almost certainly would not have read this gospel. They'd have heard it. And they wouldn't have heard it alone. They'd have heard it in a group. See, it's important to remember that at the time of Jesus, most people couldn't read. And beyond that, there were very few copies of the gospels in existence. Every manuscript had to be copied by hand and sent to various towns and cities. So when a gospel would arrive in your town or your city, all the members of your church would come together and someone would read the gospel aloud to everyone. Which teaches us two important things about how we should study the gospels. First, in addition to reading them, we should listen to them. I mean, there are wonderful apps out there that have audio versions of the Bible. The most common is one called the Bible app. You can also find versions of the Gospels being read on YouTube. So as you're studying these books, take time to listen as well as read. It will give you a completely different perspective. But even more important than that, the other thing that the practices of the early Christians teach us is that we need to study the Bible with others. And this is so critical. We aren't meant to just go off by ourselves and read the Bible. This is definitely not how the Bible was studied at the time of Jesus. We are meant to study it together, to learn from one another, to challenge one another, to disagree with one another with respect and love, and to let the Holy Spirit work through those conversations. Because as you may have heard me say before, our relationship with Jesus is intimately connected to our relationships with each other. Finally, one thing that I definitely want you to notice as you read this gospel is that the religious people in this gospel almost never recognize who Jesus is. The disciples are practically clueless throughout the whole gospel about who Jesus really is. Even after the miracles that they see Jesus perform and the things that they hear him teach, they just don't get who he is and what he's come here to do. But this is even more true with the religious leaders. He is not the Messiah that they've been expecting. And because of that, because of the expectations that they've set up, they can't receive him for who he is. In fact, it's because they don't understand him that drives them to want him to be executed. So as you go through this gospel, I want you to pay close attention to the difference between the religious people, the tax collectors, sinners, sick people on the fringes of society, the Romans and the other Gentiles, right? Pay attention to all of these people. Notice how many times these people should have no clue who Jesus is, and yet they seem to be the first to understand. And then how often those who should have recognized him first never do. And as you do this, think about what that means for us today. Are there things that blind us to seeing who Jesus really is and what he's trying to teach us? Do our religious practices and beliefs ever get in the way of us trying to truly be followers of Jesus? And then try as best as you can to approach this gospel with a blank slate, to set aside your preconceptions and just let the gospel speak. Just let Jesus speak and ask yourself, what does that change about how I follow him? What does that mean for the church, the community of people who believe in Jesus? And what does God want me to do next? I am really excited about this journey that we are about to go on together. And if you click the link above or look down in the description, you'll be able to access all of the Beyond the Words videos that we produce. And of course, if you go down below and click that subscribe button and the bell next to it, then you'll hear about these videos as soon as they're released. Some other ways that you can engage with this channel and get even more out of it is take a moment to go down there and click that like button to say that you like the video. And then of course, share it with your friends and others that you think might want to join us on this journey. And then of course, if you have any comments, go down below and write in any questions or thoughts that you have as we move forward, or even just let me know how I can be praying for you. Thank you so much for watching, for supporting this channel, and I'll see you next time as we go beyond the words.